My name is Linda Lee. I am associate professor at the University of British Columbia in Canada. And we have two very exciting speakers, Dr. Nancy Baker from University of Pittsburgh and Dr. Susan Murphy from University of Michigan. This particular session was actually presented at ARHP workshop, and we had amazing comments from the workshop, and that's the reason why we decided to invite the speakers again and run this webinar for everyone. So without further ado, Dr. Baker.
And thank you for coming today to this webinar. I'm going to be talking today about why pilot data are important for grant applications getting funded. And I am Dr. Nancy Baker from the University of Pittsburgh. I'm an occupational therapist, and my area of interest is preventing work-related musculoskeletal disorders. I do a lot of research, and I believe that pilot data is one of the more important aspects of developing a research project. And I hope when I'm done talking, you'll agree with me that pilot data and pilot studies are extremely important in developing a good research program. I'm going to start out by defining what a pilot study is, and then I'm going to talk for a while about the relationship between pilot studies and the main research project. So what are pilot studies? And I think actually I'm going to start by saying what pilot studies are not. They are not small studies that you just do because you don't have much anything better to do, or you just got a little bit of money and you need to spend it somehow, or it is a way to get a student a project. Pilot studies are a very important part of developing a research study because they are preparatory studies that are designed to test all the things that you need to know, science, process, management, and resources, so that you can do a subsequent larger study without having any major problems in these areas. So they are a way to test what you are doing before you are doing it, before you have a huge complex grant where one object being wrong can cause a huge problem in the overall process. So pilot studies tend to be test pieces. They are things that you want to know about to make sure that your project is going to run smoothly and do what you expect it to do. This is in contrast to a pilot trial, which is really more of a smaller version of a large intervention trial. A pilot trial might have all the pieces and elements and you're doing a smaller sample, but a pilot study may be a small sample for a purpose, or it may be a small aspect of a larger study for a purpose. So when developing pilot studies have their own aims, they have their own design, they have their own research questions that are all aimed at developing information for the larger study. And they should be as well designed and well thought out as a large scale trial. So they are really vital for developing larger studies. Now, first I want to just talk a little bit about the phases of intervention trials. And you can see I have a diagram here that suggests there are about five phases of trial development. And I'm going to go over the first four. The long-term implementation phase four of those trials is not really that closely related to pilot studies, so I'm not going to talk a lot about that, but I'm going to go over the first four areas. So when you're thinking about developing a study or a research project, the first types of studies are the preclinical or theory trials. These are the ones that are really preparing the theoretical background and mindset that you need in order to be able to do a larger study. So in these kinds of studies, you are going to be exploring theories and best practices that have been done in the particular area about the particular phenomena that you're interested in. And these are done to ensure that you choose the best intervention, that you develop a correct hypothesis, and that you understand some of the major confounders and strategic design issues. So a lot of the preclinical work will be literature reviews, systematic reviews that you either do yourself or read from others, or literature in all disciplines that study this phenomena. You may also do some qualitative studies in order to understand how people who have this problem or work in this area view the phenomena. So basically you're gathering information so that you can understand what's going on. The next phase is the modeling phase. In this phase, you're going to identify the components of the intervention that you believe are having an effect. So they are the mechanism of why you believe this intervention is going to be effective. You look at the outcomes that you think that this particular intervention may best affect. So you may be looking at surrogate outcomes such as nerve conduction studies. You may be looking at participation. You may be looking at a wide variety of types of outcomes that may be useful to understand the phenomena that you're interested in. And then you look to see how the phenomena interrelates with other aspects of the phenomena or with the characteristics of the sample or population that you're interested in. So the studies that are routinely done in this phase are mechanistic studies, studies that try to understand the underlying workings of the phenomena that you're interested in. Descriptive studies to describe characteristics and look at associations between things. Qualitative studies that are, again, going to be digging deeper in to understand the lived-in experience of this particular phenomena. And you may be working to identify which outcome measures are most responsive, most reliable, and best answer the questions you have about the intervention that you're planning. The next phase, the phase two, is the exploratory phase. And in this phase, you really have a good idea what your theory is, what your hypothesis is, and many of the components of the research process. But you need to understand the process of the research. You need to define some of your control information. You need to understand what needs to remain constant and variable in the components of the study. You need to make sure your intervention is replicable, that you have protocols that are going to work, and that you have a very strong plan in place. So you may work at refining your intervention and controls, developing fidelity measures, developing reliability measures. You may make sure you have feasible protocols that you can run, that your manuals are in shape. You may train personnel to make sure that you have people who can do everything that needs to be done in the study effectively and efficiently. You may test your outcome measures in the population that you're interested in working in within your environment. You may get some information about preliminary effects, and these preliminary effects may help you determine things like sample size, it may not. And you, again, may do qualitative studies, but some of these qualitative studies are studies that may look more at the effectiveness of processes rather than the effectiveness of the intervention or the experiences of your personnel. So with all of this information, once you've done various pilot studies within these phases, you wind up with the main trial or the definitive randomized controlled trial. And this is designed to compare this well-defined intervention with your well-defined controls using these very well-set-up protocols. So you can create this defensible, reproducible study. It's basically the main trial. It's what you're going for with all these previous studies. And you often is a multi-site trial with appropriate sample size to get statistical power. So you can see that of these phases of intervention trials, the first three are really pilot studies. So there is a lot of emphasis on pilot studies in phases of intervention trial, and they are absolutely necessary in being able to write and develop grants and write and develop research projects, because in granting agencies, they look very carefully that you have the ability to do the study that you say you have, that you have can demonstrate that the intervention that you're doing is effective, and that you show and demonstrate the ability to be able to do the large-scale randomized clinical trial. So let's look a little bit about what kind of data you can get out of a pilot study that can be helpful in developing your overall research plan as well as writing a grant. And keeping in mind that each of these pilot studies is going to have aims and research questions and a design that address the issues that affect the future trial. So if you're interested in doing a feasibility trial, you may not be interested at all in taking outcome measures related to an effect, but you may be very interested in taking information that looks at the number of participants you can have or the satisfaction of the information. So when you're designing a pilot study, you need to keep in mind that you need to design for that pilot study with the future trial in mind. So there are basically four types of data that can come out of a pilot study: process data, resources data, management data, and scientific data. So let's take a look at each one of these. So process data really is data on the feasibility of the process. So how are you going to run this study? And this is incredibly important data both for the research project and for writing a grant, because grant reviewers look very carefully that the person has the ability to carry through on their ideas. They look to make sure that recruitment is going to be effective. They look to make sure that they're going that the person doing the research can demonstrate the ability to retain data or retain subjects. They look to see that data collection is going to not have a lot of missing data. They want to know that the study that you're going to do is going to be effective in the process as well as the outcomes. So some of the data that you might pull up in process data, or if you're doing a pilot study to obtain process data, would look at things like recruitment and eligibility criteria. Recruitment is really important to demonstrate ability in. There are more studies that I know of that have not been successful not because the science was poor, but because they were unable to recruit what they expected to be able to recruit. So doing pilot studies to know the number of people who are eligible, what kind of recruitment rates you're going to have. Can you recruit 10 people in a month? Do you need 3 months? To understand who's going to refuse, so your response rate. And your eligibility criteria to ensure that you're not making too stringent criteria and that it's clear and inclusive. Again, I've seen a lot of studies where people start out with very stringent eligibility criteria and discover they can't recruit the people they need and have to go and change that eligibility criteria in the middle of the study, which weakens the outcomes of the study. You want to know if you can retain your participants and the rates at different follow-up points, because missing data is a bane to our existence, and we need to make sure that we can prevent people from dropping out and people from not remaining in the study. We want to make sure people are going to adhere to the study interventions, that they're going to attend their appointments. And we want to ensure that our data collection is going to be easy, that the questionnaires and surveys are understandable, that people can fill them out, that there is limited potential for missing data, and that we have checks and balances in place to make sure that we don't have missing data, and that we give sufficient time to gather all the information that we need. So you can see how important this information is, not only for being able to design a reasonable project to know how long it's going to take, but also just to demonstrate that you are capable of doing all the steps required in the process of a larger study. Resources data focuses. You'd be interested in knowing whether you have sufficient space in your physical plant to do all the things that you have planned to do, that any equipment that you're planning to use, you have somebody who can operate it, that it will operate smoothly, that it's available when you think it's going to be available, and that if it breaks down, it can be repaired in a reasonable period of time. You want to be able to show that you can communicate adequately with your fellow collaborators or your subjects, and that your software and computer access is sufficient for every aspect of your design, whether it be data collection or data analysis. And I think very importantly is that your administrative plans are going to work, that you have partners who can carry through on the proposed tasks. There's nothing worse than having a study where you have someone who says that they are going to do 50 reviews of video, and when you actually ask them to do it, they are unable to do so. You want to make sure there's support from the departments that your people are coming from, and that if a center commits, that they can and will abide to those commitments. Again, if you are in the middle of a large-scale trial and these things go wrong, you're going to have a lot of trouble, but a pilot study can allow you to check these things ahead of time. Management data really looks on human and data optimization. So you want to make sure you have personnel who are capable of managing the trial. Do you have a research coordinator who you can trust and who can do the material, do the independent things that you need them to do? Do you have investigators and staff who have the expertise in all the areas that you need? Do you have to train somebody in order to have that information? And are your collaborations strong? How are you going to collaborate? Where are the potential frictions? And how are you going to solve them before they become an issue? You want to be able to have good documentation systems in place. How are you going to track participants and what kind of systems you're going to use? Pilot studies are an excellent time to check your databases. Do they work well? Can you enter data into them? Do they interact with each other? What methods of data quality assurance are you going to use? Do pilot studies allow you to trial some of your regulatory requirements? IRBs can be a real sticking point in large-scale trials, and if you can have some experience previously with aspects that might put you at risk in an IRB and work out how that's going to be, that can save you a lot of time. I know, for instance, in where I'm in Pennsylvania nursing home, IRBs are very, very hard to get, and you need to know that ahead of time if it's going to take a while to get an IRB in place. You also need to have a good data safety monitoring plan. Finally, and not leastly, you want to make sure your ethical practices are well in place, that all your staff is well trained in human subjects, and that you have good plans in place for adverse events management. The last aspect of pilot studies is the scientific data. And well, I put this last, in a way, it's sort of the not the lowest point, but it is something that people tend to do intuitively, whereas a lot of the other process data, they don't. But the scientific data is important, and it allows you to look at things like your treatment and control interventions, making sure that they are safe, and that the dosage is correct, and that there isn't undue burden on anybody, that your outcome measures are reliable, valid, and I think most importantly, responsive in the target population. There's nothing worse than having a continuous outcome measure and you have a ceiling effect and all you can do is dichotomize your results. That can really weaken your study and prevent you from having a sufficient sample. Data analysis can be practiced and tried even if you don't get significant results. You can test your methods. And you can look for clinical effects. So what values are you going to use to indicate clinical effect? What are your effect sizes? Are there potential subgroup effects that you may want to evaluate further? And I think understanding your population characteristics on ranges of values also helps you to understand if your study is going to be successful in getting a balanced recruitment. So you can see overall that pilot studies provide a wealth of information that is useful for designing future studies and demonstrating your expertise and capability when you write a grant. It is much easier to write a grant when you know that you can recruit your subjects, when you know how your processes work, when you can be confident in your collaborations, and that you can demonstrate all these things to the grant writers. By demonstrating these to the grant reviewers, they will have confidence that you can do a large-scale clinical trial. Another important aspect of a pilot study is that it can foster particularly junior investigator development. You can write journal articles from pilot studies, you can develop connections through pilot studies, and again, demonstrate that expertise that you are capable and an expert in this particular area. And pilot studies ensure that that main trial will be appropriate and feasible and will prevent a lot of worry and concern because you will have tested things before the study actually starts. So now I'm going to turn this over to Dr. Murphy. If you have any questions about my portion of the talk, you can text or you can type them in to Dr. Lee at any time during the rest of the presentation.
My name is Susan Murphy. I work at the University of Michigan. I work primarily in intervention studies, looking at occupational therapy interventions for people with chronic pain. And I've done a lot of pilot studies in my past and present. And I'm really excited to share some recent things I found out about pilot studies when I went back to the literature. I think there's been a lot of interesting things written about pilot studies and what kind of data that you can get from them. Nancy really set the stage very nicely to now talk about a couple of examples of ways that you can show the different types of data that you can collect and to kind of prioritize what your aims are for different pilot studies. So what I'm going to be talking about a little more example-based is about research design considerations for pilot studies, some information about interpreting pilot studies, and how you can report results of pilot studies in order to build the foundation of what you want to do in that main trial. And then we have a piece from one of our other speakers, couldn't be here today, Kelly Allen, who presented at the ACR meeting, but she graciously is sharing her slides. So we're going to talk a little bit from her great information about funding opportunities for pilot studies. So I think Nancy made it pretty clear, but it is pilot studies are very important. And I liked the first statement here that research studies are adequately powered to test hypotheses because you've actually done some testing previously to be able to have an adequate power, adequately powered study. So the ways in which you do the testing is going to be different depending on kind of where you're coming from, what is unanswered for you as you're going forward, what things you need to know for that main trial. But really, you can't just start with a main trial. There needs to be some kind of confidence that reviewers will have in your ability to do a study. So oftentimes, there is this feasibility component that's built into pilot studies. And as this lower point says, really stakeholders need to be confident that you can do what you say you're going to do. And a lot of that is through demonstrating your pilot study work. Just some thoughts about design of pilot studies. The scope of your studies need to be carefully considered. And really the pieces that are going to be tested in these pilot studies are based on where your science is at. So what do you need to further understand in terms of the theory of the evidence or other sources of pilot data that can support your study? So it's kind of like pieces of the puzzle coming together. You're trying to show that you have a good foundation from which to now do this larger trial, and you're bringing together different pieces, some supported by your pilot work, some supported by the literature and the theory, all coming together to strongly support your argument for why you want to do a trial. And really, it is an artful process to design pilot studies. You have to demonstrate that you have an understanding of where your science is at, and that your scope is suitable for the resources that you have. Pilot studies are challenging because they tend to be smaller scale, and you may not have a lot of money to do them. So you really have to think carefully about what you want to do, in which case, the thoughtful process of prioritizing what you want to do is very important. And the one thing that I have never done in my past, but now I'm seeing it more in the literature, is this idea of setting criteria a priori for success of what really is a successful pilot when assessing things like feasibility. And I'm going to talk about this in a second. But now I'm going to talk a little bit, just to put it in some context, into an example. And we're going to talk about a phase one modeling study. And you've seen this figure before. We're talking about intervention components of what components are most relevant to an outcome, to the outcome. So when you're designing an intervention, often this is a place where you need to spend some time. And I'm just going to give you an example of someone that I work with. I work with an occupational therapist who is designing a knowledge translation intervention, so kind of an evidence-based practice model for rehabilitation therapists in an acute care setting to try to use evidence in practice. And this is a challenging environment because acute care, they don't have a lot of time. They're seeing a lot of patients, kind of this initial intake, and how can they better use evidence in practice? So the short-term goal for this investigator was to determine what would be included in this intervention. So the intervention is a knowledge translation intervention for therapists. And how can she deliver it to the therapist? There's a lot of different ways that you can gather pilot data to support this question. For instance, you can use focus groups. And do some focus groups with some of the therapists that work there or acute care therapists in general. You could take a few therapists and do some semi-structured interviews. So this is more of the qualitative support that Nancy mentioned earlier that's actually a very valuable piece of pilot studies, is really trying to get some feedback from your potential target group. Or you could do a more quantitative survey with health professionals. And also including supervisors could be very important when you're talking about intervention delivery, because you want it to be feasible in their everyday environment. And the route that this person took was she did focus groups with healthcare professionals and found that it was something that was valued, that the therapist wanted to use research. They thought it was important, but they felt like they didn't have a lot of skill or confidence at interpreting research articles, and that when they did read research articles, they didn't feel that they were very applicable to their practice. She also queried about barriers and found out that, not surprisingly, they reported they didn't have a lot of time to do to look at literature in their day, and that they had limited access to the resources. and that there wasn't a lot of buy-in or support from their clinical setting. So it was important, that alone was very important for her to go and talk to supervisors to try to figure out, well, how can I get buy-in? How can I reduce that barrier? So it really is kind of pivotal work that she's doing to try to figure out how would this actually be implemented if I tried it in a larger trial? How would it, and then eventually take hold for long-term implementation? So the recommendations that came out of the focus groups were that this could be done in groups, so training with therapists together, kind of working through case-based examples and looking at different articles and things. Within their work days was optimal, and that the support from their clinical settings was critical. So interpreting her findings, she designed an intervention that had tools for electronic access for research articles, and also knew that it would be important to go over how to assess quality of research articles. She was also very interested in presenting outcome assessments that were validated in the population that could potentially be used in acute care. She worked with the setting, particularly to support this initiative, which was this critical piece that allowed her the time and space to do to test out this intervention at a pilot level. So that was an example of a phase one kind of study. Now we're going to talk about a phase two study. And as Nancy mentioned, that they can be either a pilot study that tests a piece of something, or it can be a pilot trial at the phase two level where you're really doing like the mini main trial. And again, this depends on what your interests are. For this, I'm going to talk about some of the pieces. So the pieces in a phase two trial, you can look at feasibility and acceptability to participants. So you can look at pieces of your processes. Subject recruitment, which as mentioned is one of the main reasons why trials fail, is because you can't get enough people. Testing out your procedures, seeing if things are too burdensome, how much time do things take, will the people do it, are they compliant? For some of my studies, I have people wear an activity monitor at home and do a bunch of logbook entries, and it was really important for me to do pilot testing of that to see, you know, are they going to do it, and what percent compliant are they with that? Will I accept that? Are the risks of your trial understood or planned for? And sometimes this is really important, an important piece of a pilot study. Now, you might not necessarily understand all the risks or plan for them. It's nice to do trial runs to figure out, you know, what are the types of adverse events. I do very low-risk studies, but we still have adverse events that happen. Like, as I mentioned with the activity monitor, we had people that had skin reactions to the watch band and things that, like, we never really had thought about, but you now think about them once they happen and you plan for them in the future. Also about the team, are you and the team able to carry out such a project? You know, can you coordinate things in a timely manner? Are you able to collect and analyze the data? And then the support for your intervention and its components. Also, there's an aspect called treatment fidelity in behavioral interventions and rehab interventions and nursing. And I'll mention a little bit about that concept just to introduce that if you're not familiar. And then you can test out study instruments to see if they're appropriate. So this idea about criteria for success, I think, is a really important one. Because really, after you collect all this data and you've prioritized the aims that you want to test in a pilot study, you really should think about, well, what does that mean to me? And oftentimes people don't set beforehand the criteria for success that which they're going to hold themselves to at after the study. So it's really nice to think about beforehand, like, what would be a good outcome for feasibility? And these are easy things to measure, but I think if you think about it beforehand and kind of pre-plan of like, well, what would really be kind of a good thing to accept that I will choose to be an acceptable, successful trial for this pilot study, because whatever you do in your pilot study is going to be applied in a broader sense to your trial. So these are just some examples of different areas where you can set a criteria for success around different parameters. Like for screening, you know, how many people do you need to screen per month? You know, and thinking about in your time frame and how many people that you would need for a larger trial, you know, if you can screen at least 10 people per month, you know, for this study, that could be an acceptable criteria for success for this researcher. You know, the same thing you can do for recruitment. How many people would you need to enroll per month to, in a larger trial to, for that to be feasible? Randomization, treatment adherence. There's many things that you can test, but I think what's really nice is that if you think about it beforehand, then you will have some sense of not just trying to interpret data afterwards and not really know what you have. If you have criteria of success beforehand, treatment fidelity has a lot of aspects about if you're training people to give an intervention, are the therapists who are giving treatment, do they adhere to the protocol? And there's ways that you can check that. And you can check participant understanding of information that's presented, which is another aspect of fidelity. And then assessment, missing data. These are all things that you can assess for quite easily in a pilot study. So another thing that's important, that when you're prioritizing something that you want to assess, like I really need to assess feasibility of my study and I want to look at burden or dropout rates, you know, whatever your prioritization is, can affect your design. Looking at a one group versus a two group design. Now we all know, everyone says, oh, you should have a control group. It's really important to have a control group because how do you know if your intervention is effective? Well, sometimes in a pilot study, you're really not testing effectiveness as much as you're testing just feasibility. And in a one group design, feasibility is fine to test. So, but if you're looking at things like, is there a differential dropout rate if you have, if people are offered the choice of treatment or no treatment, or what is the burden for the control group versus the treatment group, and does that affect their dropout rate, then that might be a two-group design for infeasibility as opposed to a one-group design. So there's a lot of things that go into kind of designing these pilot studies, but really thinking about what is the main thing that I need to test. And then do I have the design that matches that? So just to show you a little bit about this, again, with this knowledge translation intervention study, in the phase one study, this researcher established the intervention components. And then the goal of her study was then to look at the feasibility of delivering the intervention and treatment fidelity. She chose a one group pre-test post-test design really because that was what she was prioritizing. And then this is just to give you a little background. She's enrolling 20 participants from an OT acute care unit to do a group intervention that will occur biweekly. And because she determined that the clinical setting buy-in was such a big factor in this, by doing that initial study, it really helped her with this next study because now she has the resources necessary. These are just sort of criteria for success. And as I mentioned about fidelity, this is just a component of you can test fidelity of the group leaders if you're doing this kind of intervention or a therapist. And there's different parameters around which you can measure. Put the citation below from this Belge article. This was from the NIH Behavior Change Consortium. And it's really a nice article, and there's some follow-up articles to this. But if you're doing any kind of work where you're trying to do behavior intervention, this is kind of a nice thing to frame grants around treatment fidelity to build that into your protocol. So one question that a lot of people ask is, do you need to power for pilot studies? And really, there's a lot of differences of opinion. But if you are doing a feasibility study, you need to have a sample that's large enough to establish feasibility of processes. Certainly in grant review groups and in articles, there's a lot of reviewers have a difference of opinion about whether these should be powered or not. And even in the literature, there's just a lot of divergence about this. And even if you do have, you pilot for a pilot study, if you power for a pilot study, it's not necessarily going to translate into the same effect size you would find in a larger study. Your confidence intervals are bigger. There's a lot more variability with a small sample. So you might be able to have a preliminary estimate, but really, you know, you have to figure out what do you want to prioritize in your pilot study. So a couple more slides, just interpreting and reporting results, as I mentioned before, having a priority criteria for success. There's some recent examples from the literature that that I pulled here that were some nice examples to show that feasibility was established. For instance, with recruitment, this one study said, you know, at least 70% of all eligible participants can be recruited. You know, these kind of statements that I've listed here give reviewers confidence, give grant reviewers confidence that you, you know, are able to really pull off a main trial because you've explored these issues in smaller samples. This one below this Canning article was talking about people with Parkinson's disease doing a mobility task, and they were saying that, you know, we assessed these levels of fatigue and anxiety and difficulty, and it was no problem. So, you know, that kind of, those kind of statements that you can make based on your pilot studies can be really important for grant reviewers. Pilot study characteristics, these are kind of exploratory studies. You're testing feasibility or, as Nancy mentioned, like maybe you're testing resources or your management. You may be looking at safety and dose around intervention. It's not as much for hypothesis testing because it's very hard to power for these smaller studies. It may or may not include a control group or an intention control group. I'm going to give you a quick overview of some funding opportunities, and then we'll have some time for questions. Our funding opportunities, we're talking about grants that are for standalone, you know, small studies that you want to get some funding for that have some particular aim, and these are kind of your main pilot studies. You may consider an R03 through NIH or AHRQ. R21s are a little bit bigger, and they tend to require some novelty, some kind of new idea. They are a little bit more money. And then there's some minority supplements that people can get, and people can get administrative supplements under other people's R01s, but these are a little bit more specialized, so it's important to really kind of look carefully at NIH's website for things like that. The Department of Veterans Affairs has the ability to apply for pilot studies, but you need to know people at the VA. There's some eligibility criteria. There are ways that you can partner with people at the VA to do pilot studies, but you you sort of have to have an in with someone to apply for those. And then there's various foundations, and foundations are sort of undertapped, I think. But the Rheumatology Research Foundation has some great awards. There's some other ones that are listed here. If you are looking at a particular disease or condition, you may want to look at foundations around that that may be very specific, may be very interested in your type of research. And then anything in your institution, if you're at a university, there's various usually institutional seed and pilot grants that you can apply for. So the pros and cons of grants for pilot study grants, definitely it gives you experience in grant writing and gives you a track record. It's really nice, a bio sketch to say that you've done a pilot study on what you're doing the trial on. But it does take time, especially with a federal award. For the review process is no shorter than if you were going to do a large award. And again, you're kind of in this competitive environment when you're doing a federal one, whereas institutional ones may be much easier and quicker to get. And another con is that there's usually minimal salary support because they tend to be such small awards, and usually they're only a year or two of funding. Career development awards are a very nice mechanism for people that want to become independent investigators. Most people who are on this track have heard of a K award. I think most people are asked to apply for a K award. There are other types of career development awards that you can get as well, not just the NIH K award. There are institutional awards that you can get, like postdoc and institutional K awards. The VA also has career development awards. And again, this is just kind of meeting someone and saying, hey, you know, can I potentially work there and have kind of a champion? The Rheumatology Research Foundation has some great career development awards. Depending on what stage you're at, the Scientist Development Award is for people at a more junior level, and the Investigator Award, I think, is more akin to more of a traditional K award. The Robert Wood Johnson Foundation is another area, and again, looking at your foundations, they have some nice, usually have some nice career development options. Really try to get to know the foundations that fund the type of research that you do. So career development awards are wonderful for giving protected research time for several years. K awards can last up to 5 years. They give you a lot of time, allows you to really develop pilot data, and give you kind of this mentorship or build a mentorship team around to make your research very strong. The funding rates, you know, it's more competitive all the time. And federal awards, again, take longer than internal awards. Another good idea that I don't often think about, but there's a lot of data that's publicly available and that may give you good support for pilot studies. Some examples are listed here that Kelly has listed. These are great places to start getting some papers if you need to establish a publication record in a certain area. You know, looking at what's publicly available can be a way to kind of collect some pilot data about your question. So these are great because they're free and available. They have large samples, and again, publications are so important. The problem with large data sets is that they may not exactly answer your question, so you're sort of confined to what is available, and there's no resources for you to do the work, so it's not like a career development award that has a protected time. Okay, so then other resources listing there, you can do secondary analyses from other people's data, adding variables to other people's projects, collecting qualitative data related to a new project, and then networking is so important. Who's doing work in your area? How can you collaborate with them? These are all areas which people may have ideas for how you can build and add on to their project to be a new pilot study. So just in summary, what kind of pilot data do you need that will result in a competitive grant application? If you're a novice researcher, it's really important to consult with your mentors. It's also good to have conversations with a program officer and your collaborators. People tend not to call a program officer very much, but it's important to really get a sense of where things are at from a programmatic sense, at least if you're going through the NIH. And then trying to figure out what resources do you have. Do you have the ability for internal awards? Do you have data that you can use from ongoing studies? Are there biostats help? And then what do you need? Try to fill in those pieces and those gaps. We're going to give you all the slides. You have all the slides, and here are some references each of us have used from our talk. And I think now we have time to open it up for questions. Linda?
Yep, thank you very much. One question from the participant for Dr. Baker. Is the process data stage the stage at which to test success of blinding and determine unblinding?
If you're thinking about doing a pilot study to understand if your blinding is successful, maybe asking about when you want to unblind subjects so that they know what they're getting and see how that affects the data. Basically, any pilot study that you're going to be doing, you have specific questions that you're interested in answering. And I think any question is fair game for a pilot study. So if you're having questions about whether your blinding is working, if you're having questions about when you need to unblind in order to be able to analyze the data, this can all be assessed through a pilot study by doing, as Susan might was suggesting, perhaps doing a two-group study where one group is blinded and one group isn't, or perhaps doing a study where there's a certain segment of time and you do a criteria of when you should unblind. I think, you know, like any creative research study, you're going to have to sort of figure out what you're trying to ask and how you can test it within that pilot study aspect.
Thank you. Are there any more questions from the audience?
This is Janet. My question is like about pilot study opportunities for your like mid-career or late career investigator who perhaps wants to sort of change directions of their research. Do those opportunities exist?
This is Susan. There is an opportunity through the K Awards. I believe it's like a K02 that is sort of for people that want to change direction. And I don't think there is a criteria of being early on. I think it's probably for people in mid to later stages.
When I think there are foundation grants often will not have certain foundation grants won't have a cutoff point as to age that you can try different things on. Ideally, if you're going to change direction, you might be hooking up with somebody who already has some experience who can get you a little bit of expertise to help that transition, or do a little bit of very simple, inexpensive pilot studies. Again, just demonstrate that start of expertise so you can build up some granting capability.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Yes, I have one that I'd like to ask both speakers. I wonder if you speak perhaps a little bit about you know, some of the common pitfalls when people are planning their pilot study. So, you know, for those of us who have not been doing this type of work a lot, can avoid that when we're planning our own?
I guess I can start. The thing I have learned over the years is that I need to informally test some pieces before I embark on a standalone pilot trial. sometimes you can informally ask people like, hey, would you do a study that, you know, you'd have to come 8 times and see a therapist, you know, and like just things like that. I ask to try to just get a broad sense of like, you know, before I propose a pilot study formally, you know, would people even want to come in and do what I'm proposing? So I find myself using a lot of informal kind of qualitative means. Like I may do a couple focus groups, you know, pretty cheaply with, you know, it doesn't cost a lot to do a focus group just to get a sense of, you know, if my idea will be translatable. So I think that I do stuff like that now where I kind of do some informal surveys, or if I'm working with therapists, I would say, you know, hey, would you ever do this kind of thing with a patient, and would you like to? Because I don't want to get to the point where, you know, I've developed something and even, you know, gotten funding and done a pilot study and then have people not like it, or, you know, it not to be implemented in practice.
Yeah, I would agree. I think one of the really important things is to almost have a plan of the how the different pilot studies are going to lead to your big study. So you really don't want to do this in a haphazard fashion. You should have the big study always in the front part of your mind and say, what parts do I need to do to get to this big study? So you're not wasting time on little things that you suddenly realize you could have condensed into a big pilot study, a bigger pilot study that would look at several feasibility issues or data issues. I also think it's easy to get into a pilot study trap where you just keep doing pilot studies endlessly because they're small and you feel like you haven't quite got enough information to do that big trial yet. So you'll do one more pilot study and you can, you know, you can still publish the data and stuff like that, but make sure that you have a clear plan of what you're going to use these for and how you're going to use them.
That's a really great advice. Thank the speaker for the very informative session. I certainly, you know, this is the second time I hear the talk, and I, you know, certainly get every time I hear the presentation, I learn something new. So thank you so much. Now, I would, before we sign off, I would like to remind everyone to complete the electronic evaluation because it really helped us to improve the webinars in the future and also give the feedback to our wonderful speakers. The session has been recorded and it will be made available on the ACR ARHP website shortly after today's event. So if you want to hear the content again or look at the slides, that's where you can find the information. If there are no further questions, we can draw the session to a close. Is there any final words, any final questions?
I don't know. I guess just be very careful about how you design your pilot studies and have your goal in mind.
That sounds like good words of wisdom. Yeah.
On that note, I'd like to thank everyone's participation. I wish everyone a wonderful day, and we're going to close the session now.